patience and your understanding this evening. This is going to be a wonderful event, just as how good it has already started. There is great energy in this room. I know you are the kind of people who support change, who work for change, who make change happen, and we are excited to share the stories about that tonight. My name is Leah Honsky. I am the station manager at KFAI. I'm very happy to be there. I work with a really wonderful staff and a really fantastic board of directors. Can we get a round of applause for them? For all the hard work they put in to make this happen for you. Thank you to all of them. And yes, Ms. Goodman is here. So without further ado, I am actually going to turn over our introductions to one of our favorite volunteers and programmers at KFAI Radio, Mr. Aaron Westendorp, who is down here on my right, your left. Can we have a spotlight, please? Aaron has some words he'd like to say to welcome Ms. Amy Goodman and Democracy Now! Thank you very much.
Well, hi there. I am indeed Aaron Westendorp, and I am honored to be up here tonight finally introducing an old friend. We go back quite a ways. We first met in 2008 at an event very similar to this at St. Joan of Arc Church. And then in June in that year, I attended the National Conference for Media Reform, hosted here by KFAI. Amy actually snuck me in for free. So I got to see Bill Moyers, Phil Donahue, and other luminaries there. I am not sure if I should have shared that, but whatever. I actually engineered the national broadcast on KFAI on Fridays and got to do the outro into Lydia Howell's show Catalyst. And I loved hearing Democracy Now! As it unfolded hour before. And I had to fit all the promos in the allotted break times. And one time I had to play a promo over Billie Holiday's Strange Fruit, which felt so wrong. But yes, I could go on and on about how cool this woman is, but do you really know Amy Goodman? I am here to expose her as the fraud she is. Only kidding, only kidding. Let me walk you through what is about to happen, ladies and gentlemen. This isn't my first rodeo here. You were actually in a church service here in the Parkway Theater. The Church of the Good Man, as I like to call it. As any church, you may begin by standing up. You won't sing any hymns. You will begin by just standing and clapping as Amy approaches the podium or the pulpit, whatever you want to call it. It looks like that podium has a hex on it. Be careful up there, Amy, then she will begin her sermon, which, as sermons tend to go, we'll ramble on and on. But this sermon will actually hit high notes throughout. Because after all, this is about movements that change the world. Like the Arab Spring and Occupy. Trailblazers. And people who swim against the current. So, I want to wish you a challenge tonight. As you hear Amy talk, I challenge you to pick a topic that she covered tonight. Then maybe in the lobby after, or in here over by the left side of the stage where Amy will be signing her book. Write down the topic in big letters, hold it above your head, and see if any other people latch onto your cause. It may be war, or the media, or police brutality. I am challenging you because of the old saying, don't shoot the messenger, or in this case, don't glorify the messenger, then let them do all the work. The messenger is the messenger, friends, a link in the chain. Amy is just a step in the long process to democracy. We may not get democracy now, but we may get democracy sooner than later. Ladies and gentlemen, your friend and mine, Amy Goodman.
Is there any chance we could have lights up a little bit here so I could actually see all of you?
Thank you.
Not on me, but on all of you. I mean, me, yeah. Could we, like, so that I, you see, I, on Democracy Now, I never get to see, actually, the people except those that I'm interviewing, and so it would be really lovely today to be able to see you. Is there any chance of getting a little more light? Oh, there's no house lights. Fascinating. But... Aaron, thank you so much for that lovely introduction. Yeah. My colleague Denis Moynihan, Aaron's friend and mine, co-author of Democracy Now, was supposed to be here today as well to address you. Denis is an extraordinary talent, a writer, a community organizer. I call him the Johnny Appleseed of independent media, building a full power FM station up in Winter Park in Colorado, low power in Denver, and helped to build Democracy Now! To what it is today. And the only problem was, well, we're on this crazy 100 city tour. We're trying to get Danny DeVito to read those words of Aaron's. And when Denis failed, he was too ashamed to show up. No, not really, but we were. But Aaron, that was really eloquent, and I so deeply appreciate it, but not as much as I appreciate your friendship over the years. It's been a pleasure knowing you, and I look forward to many, many more years of us together. Now, we're on a crazy 100 city tour. On this leg, this morning we were in Portland, Oregon. We did the show at 5 a.m. You know, we have to do the show on the road on the West Coast. It's 5 a.m, which means we have to get there at 3 a.m. And then we do a couple of events in the day. Last night we did a big benefit for KBOO Radio, which is community radio in Portland, in the evening, in the afternoon. That was Sunday, right? We were in Eugene, Oregon. Also celebrating community radio. In this last leg, we flew from, I think it was Sarasota to Spokane, Washington. Then we took the sleeper train down 2 a.m. from Spokane to Seattle, had a big event at Seattle Town Hall for KBCS, the community radio there. It's been a wondrous and a little bit frightening journey. It was Denis's birthday last week, and I was trying to think what to get him, and I realized as we zigzag across the country back and forth, I'm gonna get him a map, because he's the one who organized this insane journey. Now, we started in Ithaca College on April 6th. April 8th, we're at The Ohio State University in Columbus. They've just added the. Then on April 9th, we moved to Kansas City, working with Left Bank Books in the morning. And we were celebrating, and we're in the library. I love libraries, independent bookstores, and independent media. All are sanctuaries of dissent, which is why it is so great to be here working today with this wonderful bookstore. I hope Sam is able to come in here and not just be outside with Common Good Bookstore. Common Good, independent media, half as old as Democracy Now! So we began Democracy Now! In 1996. It was the only daily election show in public broadcasting. It aired on 9 community radio stations, 5 of them Pacifica stations. And the day after the election, it was Clinton versus Dole versus Ross Perot. We thought we'd wrap up that project, move on to another, but it didn't quite work out that way because more stations wanted the show after the election than before. Why? I think because we were giving voice to the grassroots. It's that hunger for independent voices instead of the pundits you get on all the networks who know so little about so much, explaining the world to us and getting it so wrong. So we went from 9 community radio stations in 1996. September 11th, week 2001, we were broadcasting the closest national broadcast to Ground Zero by chance. And we, the local public access TV station in New York, Manhattan Neighborhood Network, asked if they could broadcast Democracy Now! This was before that week, but that week we were to begin coincidentally. And we went on as emergency broadcasting, and well, we never looked back. It just spiraled. As soon as we went on one TV station, stations around the country, like SPNN, like stations throughout the United States, TV stations asked if they could run Democracy Now! Soon we were sending our video cassettes by FedEx, because I thought it's breaking news, it shouldn't be more than a day old. And then when we would be on the public access station, radio would ask, can we run you? And then it became NPR stations, and then it was PBS stations, and 20 years later, we're broadcasting on over 1,400 public radio and television stations around the country and around the world. In Sweden, we broadcast several times a day in many cities. It's crazy. We perfected a way to send broadcast quality video through the internet, and so they pull it down there on radio and television. In Japan, we're called the Other America, and they've had commentators commenting afterwards. In South Africa, throughout Europe, in Latin America, our headlines are translated into Spanish in both text and audio form, so that Latin American stations, Spanish stations in Spain, and Spanish language stations in the United States can run the headlines. They suffer from media consolidation, just like the English language press. And if you want to learn Spanish, or you speak Spanish, you want to learn English, or you're a teacher, or you want to teach it one way or the other, put our texts on our website. You know, everything is transcribed every day. The English and the Spanish next to each other, and it isn't, you know, the silly stuff when you're learning a language. It is the current news, how to talk about it in the world, in both languages. And it is an Uruguayan collective voices it, so you'll hear it also in audio form, and radio stations all over the world run that. I mean, it is the largest public media collaboration in this country. It is growing exponentially now. But we all began at Pacifica Radio. Pacifica Radio's first station was KPFA in 1949. The first Pacifica station was in Berkeley, founded by a man named Lou Hill, who was a conscientious objector, a war resister. When he came out of the detention camps after the war, he said, there's got to be a media outlet not run by corporations that profit from war, but run by journalists and artists. And that's how Pacifica was born, as George Gerbner, the late dean of the Annenberg School of Communications at the University of Pennsylvania, would say, not run by corporations that have nothing to tell and everything to sell that are raising our children today. So, KPFA 1949, KPFK in Los Angeles 1959, my station in New York, WBAI 1960. It went on the air, and within a year or two, is broadcasting a debate between Malcolm X and the great writer James Baldwin over the effectiveness of nonviolent civil disobedience, the lunch counter sit-ins of the South. KPFT went on the air in Houston 1970 and WPFW in Washington 77, the five Pacifica stations, the Fab Five. So KPFT in Houston in the Petro Metro is the only radio station in the country to be blown up. It was after a few weeks of operation in the spring of 1970. The Ku Klux Klan strapped dynamite to the base of the transmitter and blew it to smithereens, right in the middle of Arlo Guthrie singing Alice's Restaurant. And I thought that was a good song. But so they blow it up, and you know, it's not as if Pacific had money for advertising. The silver lining was it certainly blew it into the consciousness of the potential listening audience of the people of the Petro Metro. I don't recommend this as an advertising strategy, but they get back on their feet and they go on the air again, and that's terrific. And the Klan then straps 15 times the dynamite to the base of the transmitter and blows it up again. So this is a very big deal. It takes them months to get it together, to rebuild the transmitter. It's now January of 1971. And when they do, PBS comes in to broadcast the moment. Orlo Guthrie comes back to finish his song live on the air. And KPFT, the Phoenix, rises from the ashes. Now, I don't remember if it was the Grand Dragon or the Exalted Cyclops, because I often confuse their titles. He said it was his proudest act. I think that's because he understood how dangerous Pacifica is, how dangerous independent media is, how dangerous KFAI is. Dangerous because it allows people to speak for themselves. And when you hear someone speaking from their own experience, whether it is a Palestinian child or an Israeli grandmother, whether it is an uncle from Iraq, an aunt from Afghanistan, a kid from the South Valley in Albuquerque, where we just were speaking at RFK High School, it's largely, overwhelmingly undocumented immigrant student population in that school. Whether it's a kid from East St. Louis or whether it's Aaron speaking through this machine, but you know it's his own words. That breaks down barriers that fuel the caricatures and the stereotypes that these hate groups feed on. You know, you might hear what they say and think, sounds like my bubba or my baby, my brother, my aunt, or my wisecracking cousin. And I'm not saying you will agree with what you hear. I almost never agree with Aaron. But I mean, how often do we agree with our family members even? But you begin to understand where someone is coming from. And that understanding is the beginning of peace. I think the media can be the greatest force for peace on earth. Instead, all too often, it's wielded as a weapon of war, which is why we have to take it back. Now, I'm so sorry Denis isn't here. He would have so enjoyed being here. We basically were almost missing our plane, and we had a rented car as we were racing from the studio in Portland to the airport, and we just basically had to choose which one of us got on this plane if we ran as fast as we could. And Denis was left with three 70-pound suitcases, because it's not clothes. It's half a TV studio. It's absolutely amazing. We've perfected a way to go into a community. For example, last Friday, I don't know how often you all listen to Democracy Now!, but we had that debate, Bernie or Bust, and it was in Bellevue, Washington. It was with Shauna Swant, who is the city council member in Seattle, and Mike McGinn, who's the former mayor. They're both Bernie supporters. McGinn says, though, if Hillary Clinton gets a nomination, he will support her. And Shauna Swant says, no, she would support like Jill Stein of the Green Party, or she wants Bernie to run as an independent. Now, that's a very interesting debate. It's not just your Republican-Democratic debate. There are so many debates in different communities that are so much more, I mean, they're more subtle and they're more ongoing around the country and probably more productive. And we wanted to broadcast that. Now, where we were was not in a typical TV studio, which we often are in when we're traveling on the road, which is much easier. We did the broadcast from Bellevue College, used to be known as Bellevue Community College, a two-year school outside of Seattle. And the students were our staff. They staffed the cameras, the men and the women. They were there at 3 in the morning. The show was at 5. It was absolutely beautiful. And they have a TV studio, but they've never broadcast out to the world. But we, Denis, researched and figured out the best gizmo to use that enables a TV studio to broadcast out. And so we carry that on our backs along with with everything else, the means of communicating with our studio in New York. I don't know if it was Denis who lost or I did, but I got on that plane, and now I know, no, I really know that, and Denis is so sorry not to be here. He called from Salt Lake City. He wasn't stranded there, but he was making his way here. We knew that of the two of us, it would be most likely I would get on the plane the flight was taking off in 10 minutes when I got to the airport. And I have a little more success tearing through the line, begging, pleading, not being afraid to go down on my knees, saying, please, I would do it for you if you were late. Please, sir, please, ma'am, please, please, to the babies, please, please. And I made it, definitely the last one on that flight.
Yeah.
And then after doing the show tomorrow morning, I'll be speaking to Ralph Nader tomorrow. You know, he's planning a big event next week in Washington, D.C., you know, about the previous protests that have taken place over the last few weeks in Washington, Democracy Awakening, Democracy Spring, people following the footsteps of Granny D, protesting the corruption of money in politics. 1,200 people arrested. The media hardly covered them, but I'll talk about that in a minute. This journey has been quite something, both the journey of Democracy Now! Over 20 years and now going around the country and also into Canada. So I just told you the story of KPFT and, you know, what happened 46 years ago. You know, it's a story of history. I cannot believe we're talking about the Ku Klux Klan today in the 2016 presidential election. I mean, how could it be? How could it be that the presumptive nominee of a major American political party finds it difficult to disavow support from the Ku Klux Klan? I mean, I'm talking about Donald Trump, and of course, who's the front runner, is the presumptive nominee of the Republican Party. When asked by Jake Tapper on CNN if he would disavow support of an avowed white supremacist Klan leader, David Duke, I can't remember if he was the Exalted Cyclops or the Grand Dragon, but David Duke and the Ku Klux Klan, if he would disavow support. And Donald Trump wavered, you know. He said he'd have to look more deeply into this. Now, when was the last time you heard Donald Trump say he had to look more deeply into anything before he spoke? And what is it that he really had to weigh? He had to know exactly which Klan chapter, because he wouldn't want to generalize to all the KKK chapters in the United States. I mean, as I said, we were the closest national broadcast to Ground Zero, September 11, 2001. That horrific moment when 3,000 people were incinerated in an instant. We'll never actually know how many people died on that day, because those who go uncounted in life go uncounted in death. And they are the undocumented immigrants, workers who might have been around the World Trade Center. But that number is terrifying and horrific. However, it's not the first time that terror came to US soil. Ask any African American about slavery. Ask any Native American about what's happened in this country. It was a moment of horror. Now, the Ku Klux Klan is a homegrown American terrorist organization, right? This is an organization that has terrorized populations, particularly African Americans, for decades, killing thousands, lynchings, mutilations, maimings. We have to be very clear about what this organization represents, so that history doesn't repeat itself. It's also why we need independent media to go deeply into this history. Yeah. It's absolutely critical. A history of white supremacy in this country, and we experienced it again just last June, right in Charleston, South Carolina. A young white supremacist goes into a Bible study class at the Mother Emanuel AME Church in Charleston. There were a group of parishioners there, and their reverend, the beloved reverend, Clemente Pinckney was there, who's also a longtime South Carolina state senator who'd raced back from Columbia, the state capital, because he just wanted to be with his flock, with his parishioners for Bible study midweek in the evening. And they were just wrapping up. Well, this young man had walked in about an hour before. They welcomed him, though they didn't know him. Everyone knew each other but him. And then at the end of this Bible study class, he blew them away. He killed them, almost all. One woman, he told her he would spare her life because he wanted her to bear witness, to tell the world what he had done. A couple of days later, when Dylan's storm roof was arraigned, the family members of the victims and the survivors put the country to shame when they forgave him. They forgave him. I think Dylan's storm roof unwittingly blew the roof off the Confederacy. So what would happen next? State Senator Pinckney would lay in state in the Capitol Rotunda, one of only a few African Americans ever to lay in state there. Thousands streamed by his casket, but not before having to pass outside the Confederate flag waving high, tall, and proud. How is that possible? Right? You know that all the flags of South Carolina flew at half-mast. The American flag on the grounds of the South Carolina legislature, of course, flew at half-mast, the massacre of the Beautiful Nine. Only this flag stood at full-mast, because it couldn't be ever even brought to half-mast. It actually first flew atop the Capitol in the early 60s as a response to the civil rights movement. Then in 2000, the NAACP and some sports franchises said they would boycott the state if they didn't take it down. So the compromise was it would be put on the Capitol grounds, but it couldn't fly at half-mast, and anyone who tried to deface it or take it down would face increased penalties. And so there it stood. Then you had, of course, Democracy Now! Raced to Charleston. We broadcast from outside the Mother Emanuel Church. I really encourage people to see that broadcast. And then we went over to the College of Charleston Arena. Thousands packed in for the mass funeral. President Obama was there. He sang Amazing Grace, you may remember. And then the individual funerals continued the next day. And what's amazing about this is that even through that, the South Carolina legislature did not take down the flag, but they began to discuss the possibility of a debate. And I think if you asked, most people in this country would probably say the person most responsible for taking it down was South Carolina Governor Nikki Haley, who sort of led the charge. But that's not who first took the flag down. It was 5:30 in the morning on June 27, 2015, 10 days after the massacre at the Emanuel AME Church. The South Carolina State House glowed in the morning light. Bree Newsom, a 30-year-old African-American woman from Charlotte, North Carolina, walked toward the main entrance to the building. She was accompanied by Jimmy Tyson, a young white man from North Carolina, and others who scouted the grounds. They observed the scene around the State House, waiting until there were no guards visible. After about 30 minutes, Tyson and Newsom made their move. They walked swiftly toward the Confederate monument, which stands directly in front of the main steps. The tall monument, topped with a heroic image of a Confederate soldier, pays tribute to those who have glorified a fallen cause, slavery. The two activists proceeded to the 30-foot-high flagpole that stood directly behind the monument. The Confederate battle flag flapped lazily at the top. Bree Newsom donned her climbing gear, which she had learned how to use a few days before. And she began ascending the pole swiftly. Guards noticed, began shouting at her to come down. Reaching the top of the flagpole, she grabbed the Confederate flag and unhooked it. She declared, "You come against me with hatred and oppression and violence. I come against you in the name of God." Newsom clutched the symbol of the Confederacy and said, "This flag comes down today." Woo! She lowered herself slowly along with the flag. As soon as she reached the ground, Newsom and Tyson were arrested. Video of the protests went viral, was seen around the world. Her bail fund quickly raised more than $125,000. Ava DuVernay, director of the Oscar-nominated film Selma, was among the many to hail her, tweeting, "I hope I get the call to direct the motion picture about a black superhero I admire. Her name is Bree Newsom." But within about an hour, two state house workers raised a new Confederate flag on the Capitol grounds. I mean, it is astounding to think, after the massacre, after the mass funeral the day before, the authorities, the powers that be, actually raised that Confederate flag again deliberately as the massacre victims were being lowered into the ground. We raced from the funerals to the Columbia jailhouse where we thought Bree and Jimmy were taken, and we actually made it into the arraignment cell. And we saw them charged with defacing state property, facing a penalty of up to 3 years in prison and a $5,000 fine. Then we went into the lobby. More people were gathering, hoping they would be released. And I talked to a young woman named Tamika Lewis, who'd come with Bree, hoping to participate in the action. She said to see that flag actually come down and all of the things that it represents being taken down by a strong black woman was one of the greatest symbolic images that one person could ever witness. Another young woman named Carol Parker from Columbia did not know Bree, but came to the jail because she had passed the Confederate flag every day for so many years that humiliated and denigrated her. And she said, "Bree has done what our governor hasn't had the courage to do, what our General Assembly hasn't had the courage to do. She went up there and did what had to be done when it needed to be done. Yes, tell it from the rooftops. It was Bree Newsom who brought down the symbol of the Confederacy in South Carolina."
Yeah. Woo!
A modern day Rosa Parks, and it, which brings me to Rosa Parks, that story that I've told here before. But why? You know, that is one story that we read about in our history books, that when Rosa Parks died a few years ago, the media certainly talked about the significance of Rosa Parks, but they got it wrong. The media said, this was CNN, "Rosa Parks is a tired seamstress. She was no troublemaker." See, Rosa Parks was a first-class troublemaker. She knew exactly what she was doing on December 1st, 1955, when she sat down on that bus and refused to get up for a white passenger. She was arrested. 4 days later, December 5th, 1955, when she goes to court, the Montgomery Improvement Association has their meeting as they choose as their leader to lead the bus boycott that will desegregate the transportation system in Alabama. They choose as their leader a young minister who had just moved into town. His name was Dr. Martin Luther King. Rosa Parks helped launch Dr. Martin Luther King. Rosa Parks was the secretary of the local NAACP. She came out of radical, she was the secretary. She worked with E.D. Nixon. He was the president of the local chapter. He came out of radical labor politics. He worked with the greatest organizer of the 20th century, A. Philip Randolph, who organized the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters, the thousands of black conductors on the Pullman trains were all called George, not because their mothers named them George, but because they were named for the man who owned the trains, George Pullman. That sort of shows you why they needed to organize. So then A. Philip Randolph would go on to organize the 1963 March on Washington with Bayard Rustin, the great gay, black, pacifist activist. Together they organized that major event in U.S. history where Dr. King gave his I Have a Dream speech. This is the tradition that Rosa Parks came out of. She trained at the Highlander Center. And so many people, black and white, did to more effectively strategize to change the racist laws. Right before Pete Seeger died, I had the honor of interviewing him in the studios of Democracy Now! And he described, you know, perfecting the folk song, "We Shall Overcome." And he was doing it at the Highlander Center. And Dr. King came in. And he asked Pete to sing, "We Shall Overcome." And Dr. King listened and said, "That's a catchy tune." And of course, it becomes the anthem of the civil rights movement. I mean, this is what was happening, and this was Rosa Parks' life, and she knew just what she was doing. She had, in fact, sat down on the bus before and refused to get up for a white passenger. Other young women had. You never know when that moment will come, that magic moment. But if you're involved with social justice, with social change, you help to build a foundation that will change the future, that will make history. The media denigrates activists, but what can be more noble than dedicating your life to making the world a better place? Before I talk about one year that rocked the world more recently, I wanted to share the context of that time, even what we miss when people just roll their eyes when they hear, or perhaps get a shudder when they hear Donald Trump weighing whether to disassociate himself from the Klan. Rosa Parks in 1955, to show how brave she was, go back to the summer. That summer of 55, the summer of Emmett Till, a 14-year-old African-American boy, his mother, Mamie Till, they lived in Chicago. She wanted her boy out of the city for the summer and sent him to Money, Mississippi to be with his aunt and uncle and cousins. He was ripped out of bed by a white mob, and they said he wolf whistled at a white woman. Wolf whistled. Emmett had a stutter, and his mother taught him, whenever you feel that stutter coming on, whistle. He ended up in the bottom of the Tallahatchie River. When his body was dredged up and sent back to Chicago for the wake and the funeral, his mother, Mamie Till, in the midst of the greatest grief of her life, her only boy, was essentially lynched. She said she wanted the casket open for the wake and the funeral. She wanted the world to see the ravages of racism, the brutality of bigotry. Thousands streamed by his casket and saw, and then Jet Magazine and other black publications actually photographed his distended, mutilated head. And those photographs were published, and they were seared into the history and consciousness of this country. Mamie Till had something very important to teach the press of today. Show the pictures. Show the images. Could you imagine if for just one week we saw the images of war? If above the fold of every surviving newspaper you saw a baby dead on the ground in Afghanistan, and you learned her name and who her parents were and what their aspirations for her were. I mean, learned her name, that's what dignifies a life, and there was a whole article about her. Imagine if the top of every radio and TV newscast was a story of a woman blown up in a drone strike by the United States in Yemen, maybe attending a wedding party, and you learned about the young couple who'd fallen in love and where this wedding party was and how this happened. And if everyone on their Facebook wall, every email, every tweet referred to a soldier dead or dying. For just one week, Americans are a compassionate people. They would say, no, war is not the answer to conflict in the 21st century. We need a media that tells us these stories. My brother David and I wrote a couple of books together, the first called Exception to the Rulers. That's what all the media should be. It shouldn't just be the motto of Democracy Now. The second called Static. And the reason we called it that is even in this high-tech digital age, all we get is static, that veil of distortion and lies and misrepresentations and half-truths. When we need the media to give us the dictionary definition of static, criticism, opposition, unwanted interference, we need a media that covers power, not covers for power. We need a media that is the for the state, not for the state. And we need a media that covers the movements that create static and make history. Sorry, I tend to cough a little during these talks, but it's led to some very interesting experiences because, well, on this crazy journey, I was in Redway, California, Northern California, celebrating KMUD, Community Radio in Northern California. And, we had just come from Colorado where cannabis is legal. And, you know, in California, it isn't really overall. But in Northern California, I swear, it's 90% of the economy. And it's so open. I mean, it didn't used to be, but at the reception, right? You're just meeting people, and you say, well, what do you do? And you say, I'm a businessman in town. Oh, what do you sell? Pot. Or I grow. Oh, really? You like a couple of plants, you know, acres. Or you say to a young woman, what do you do? I'm a manicurist. Oh, at a local salon in town? No, I clip buds. So I was giving the talk, and as usual, I started coughing, and Ricola is my lozenge of choice, and so people started tossing Ricolas up, you know? And so I unwrapped one, and this doesn't look like a Ricola at all. At least not where I come from in New York. It's been a very interesting trip. I mean, journey. Journey. I did not say trip, I said journey. But one of the things, and I wish Denis was here, but he talks about, is the effect of independent media and how important it is in communities, particularly communities that have very little access to information, which is really all of us, but a captive audience. He had worked for a period of months in Lawrence, Kansas, with Leonard Peltier, the Native American leader who's imprisoned, who applied for clemency under Clinton, didn't get it, now is appealing again to President Obama, who just recently granted scores of people clemency, but not Leonard Peltier, who's now in prison in Florida, but was in prison at Leavenworth. And Denis would talk to him every morning at 8. That's when Leonard would call the office. Because from 7 to 8, he and his fellow prisoners would gather in the so-called recreation area around a tiny transmitter radio, a real small transistor radio, because the warden had required it be even smaller than it used to be. And all these big guys gathered round to listen to Democracy Now! And at 8 o'clock, he wanted to discuss what he had heard. And throughout the day, he said, the prisoners discuss what they heard. Then we were just in Atlanta, Georgia, celebrating WRFG, Radio Free Georgia. And they told the story of how they got a contribution of something like $325, which is a really nice size contribution, you know, during their fundraising drive, from 65 prisoners at the maximum security prison nearby, each giving $5. Because they listened to Democracy Now! And other programs on WRFG. And then right before we left on this tour, we got a call, an email from one of the administrators of a prison in England. I told you this is a global show. He had asked about a year ago if they could run Democracy Now! In their closed circuit TV system within the prison in England. And we'd said, sure, of course. And they have for the last year. And he said there has been a 50% increase in prisoners enrolling in classes as a direct result of Democracy Now! People want to be engaged. Did someone want to taste this first? I really do think that independent media will save us. Independent media, information is the oxygen of a democracy. Now, speaking of Leonard Peltier, I don't know if I talked about this the last time I was here, and I'm sure Aaron would know. Did I tell the story of the President Clinton phone call? Good. Okay, I'm going to tell it then. And maybe some of you have heard it, but it happened in 2000. It happened on Election Day. And we were going on the air then at 9, now we go on the air at 8, and it was just a radio show. It wasn't a television show. And we had two producers at the time, Brad Simpson and Maria Carrion. She had flown in from Spain to help out during the election season. So they had gone into the studio. It was like a minute to 9. And the phone rang, and I, you know, we wouldn't usually pick it up, but people wouldn't usually call, and I thought maybe it's an emergency. I picked it up, and they said White House Communications, and I thought they said White Horse Communications. It's a famous tavern in the Village in New York, you know, where Dylan Thomas drank himself to death. And they said, the president wants to talk to you. And I said, the president of what? Like a tavern? And at 9 o'clock in the morning? And what do they have, a PR company, a communications, White Horse Communications? And I said, the President of the United States of America. Oh, White House Communications. Oh, okay. I said, President Clinton? They said, that's right. He wants to get on and talk about getting out the vote. Hillary Clinton was running for Senate, and Al Gore was running for president. And I thought this must be a hoax, but anyway, fine. I gave him the internal number of the radio. The producers were yelling at me to come in. The music was swelling, and I hung up and went into the studio, and I said, hey, as the music was going on, from Pacifica, this is Democracy Now! And we went to the clip, and I said, hey, very quickly, it may be that President Clinton calls in. If he does, definitely pick up the phone, but think of some questions right now, although I think this whole thing is a hoax, and it probably won't happen. All that and more coming up. He didn't call. It was the show. And then we went off to get coffee because this was going to be a long day. We figured they'd announce the president like around midnight or 1 in the morning, right? Bush v. Gore, who's going to get it? Who knew it would last for 5 weeks? It would be a Supreme Court selection, not an election. But at the time, we thought, okay, this is going to be quite a day. And it was at that point, as the three of us were walking out, that we hear this shriek from the control room. It was Gonzalo Alberto, who is the host of Alternativa Latina on WBAI. It was the alternative Latino music show. He said, the president is on the phone, come quickly. So we raced in, and Gonzalo was paralyzed. He was standing over the audio board. All the music faders were up, playing salsa music. All the microphones were down, and you could hear President Clinton saying, is anyone there? Is anyone there? I didn't really know how to work the audio board, but I leaped over it. I pulled all the music faders down, and I didn't know which mic was which, so I just threw them all up. The whole room was hot. It was Gonzalo was his producer, me with our two producers, and we began. I said, hello, President Clinton. Yes, we're here. I understand you are encouraging people to get out the vote. What do you say to those who are concerned that both the Democratic and Republican parties are captured by corporations? And he answered. I mean, he went in there full tilt, and he gave a response about why people should get out and vote, and totally disagreed with me. And then, you know, I had him on, and this was a major issue at the time. Would Leonard Peltier be granted clemency? We knew that Clinton was weighing it. And so I asked him, will you be granting Leonard Peltier clemency? And he talked about this. I asked a follow-up question on that. Then we asked together about the napalming and bombing of the Puerto Rican island of Vieques, and would the U.S. Navy stop? We asked about the sanctions regime against Iraq. Remember this? This was in 2000. Two UN Assistant Secretary Generals had quit calling them genocidal, killing something like 500,000 children. Remember, Madeleine Albright, Secretary of State, was famously asked by Leslie Stahl of 60 Minutes, do you think it was worth the price, 500,000 dead children? And Madeleine Albright said yes. She would later say she regretted that response, but that was after she was Secretary of State. This was what she said when she had power. I asked about the death penalty, about President Clinton, you know, in the midst of his own presidential campaign, going back to Arkansas to preside over the execution of a mentally challenged, mentally disabled men. And then I asked about the success of Ralph Nader. And I asked if he thought that he might be, President Clinton, be responsible for his success. He was running for president at the time. Because he, President Clinton, had taken the Democratic Party to the right. And now Clinton got angry. And he said, I find you hostile, combative, and at times disrespectful. And so I said, well, they're just critical questions, and I just have a few more. So then I asked him, I said, you know, Al Gore said his first action in office would be to outlaw racial profiling, and which was a very good thing. But I said, you guys have been in office for 8 years. Why haven't you done it until now? Anyways, very interesting conversation. It went on for about a half an hour. You know, that was the alternative Latino music show for the day on Election Day 2000. And President Clinton said he had to get off. And that was the end of that. It got a lot of attention. And the next day we played it on Democracy Now. And right after that, I went into the office. This is when we still had wired phones. And I got a call from a reporter. It already had a lot of headlines. He said, how did this happen? You know, how did you have this extended conversation with like the most powerful person on earth? And then the other phone rang. And they said, White House Communications. And I knew this was a White House calling. And they said, you're gonna be banned from the White House. And I said, I'm gonna be banned from the White House? But he called me, I didn't call him. I said, wait a second, just 1 minute, please, because I had this reporter on the phone. I said, I'm sorry, it's the White House. I have to call you back. He said, no, do not hang up this phone and do not put me on hold. Just put the phone down. So I put it down. I said, okay, that's not fair. Why would I be banned from the White House? And they said, well, we told you, you broke every rule. All the protocol, the whole agreement that we had. I said, agreement? We talked for like 20 seconds. I didn't even know who you were. And what do you mean agreement? I'm the person you talked to. I made no agreement. They said, we told you that he wanted to talk about getting out the vote. And you asked question 1, 4, and 7 related to that issue, perhaps. But no other question that related to that. I said, I asked 3 questions that President Clinton wanted to address. I think I'm really falling down on the job. I said, I didn't agree that that was the only thing I was going to ask. And I said, how many reporters did you talk to this morning, yesterday morning? And they said, like 40 in New York, because he was calling for getting out the vote for Hillary. And I said, they only stuck to that one issue? And they said, that's right. I said, it's just a very sad comment on American journalism. But I said, it does sound like you have a transcript because you said questions 1, 4, and 7. Could you send it to us? Because that's how we work. Volunteers send transcripts and we post them online. You could be our volunteer for the day. They didn't appreciate that. And then they said that we told you he had 2 or 3 minutes. You kept him on the phone for over half an hour. And I said, he's the most powerful person on earth. He's the leader of the free world. He could hang up if he wants to. And then they said, we're not saying he didn't have a good time. But, you know, we are not supposed to go on bended knee to those in power. We occupy a special position in this country. There's a reason why journalism is the only profession explicitly protected by the U.S. Constitution, because we're supposed to be the check and balance on power.
Yeah.
Which is why, I was deeply concerned coming here in 2008 to cover the Republican convention, that my colleagues and I were arrested simply trying to cover a celebration of democracy, which was the, you know, that's what the conventions are. The Democratic Convention had just taken place in Denver. There were mass protests there. That was when President Obama was first nominated. And then we flew into St. Paul, and that was going to be the convention of John McCain and Sarah Palin, you may remember. And we're covering that, and there was mass protest there as well. It's pretty straightforward what we have to do as journalists. And the first day, you may remember, some of you might have been there, the first day, I think it was September 1st, it was Labor Day, it was a beautiful blue sky day, it was a Monday, the convention was starting that night. And there was mass protest, 10,000 people marching for peace, led by soldiers, actually, people in full military regalia who are deeply opposed to war, and many, many, many civilians. And we covered all that, and we were interviewing people, as we do. And then Rick Rowley and I went to the floor of the convention. You know, you have to have, like, the top security credentials, go through the whole national security system, because you're going to be able to interview delegates and presidents and vice presidents, and we went through all that. It takes a long time, and you get to the floor, and you have a little while, and then you have to leave. And my colleagues, Nicole Salazar and Shufa Belkadus, went to St. Paul Neighborhood Network, SPNN, to digitize tape for the show the next day. So Rick Rowley and I were on the floor of the convention. You know, Rick, who Oscar-nominated film with Jeremy Scahill, Dirty Wars, and won a Sundance major award in cinematography for that film. So we were working together, and then I get a call from our senior producer, Mike Burke. I think it was in the middle of the Alaskan delegation, right? At the delegation, the hottest delegation of that convention. And I was asking people questions. I get this call, hey, come quickly. Sharif and Nicole have been arrested. They've been bloodied by police. I said, what are you talking about? They're in the studio digitizing tape. Mike said, no, get to 7th and Jackson. I'm not from your city. I didn't know where this was. We go tearing out of the convention. Racing down the street, finally find this area. It's like an old parking lot, 7th and Jackson, right near the SPNN studios. And we see that riot police have contained the whole area. And, you know, I've done this before. You have to get your reporters out. In New York, there was a critical mass bike ride, and thousands of riders were going through Times Square. And one of our reporters had rigged cameras up on her bicycle to give you that feel of riding through the streets of New York and what a critical mass bike ride was like. And when it came to Times Square, the police netted them right in the middle of them flying down the street. They picked up that orange netting and they all tumbled and they wrapped them up. And Elizabeth was caught in the middle of that. And I had to go and you find the, you know, the commanding officer with the scrambled eggs, the gold braid, and you say, as I did in New York, you know, got to get a reporter out of there. And finally, after pushing hard, we get our reporter out so that they're not arrested. And they're doing their jobs. And so that's what I came to look for at 7th and Jackson. And the riot police had surrounded the area. People were arrested inside, but it was fully contained. So I came running down the line of police, and I was looking for the gold braid. I didn't see it, so I just stopped a few of the officers, and I said, you know, I said my name. I said, I want to speak to your commanding officer. Two of our reporters inside, they've been arrested. We need to have them released. I mean, it wasn't seconds before they ripped me through the police line. They twisted my arms back. I was saying, oh my God, please don't arrest me. And they slapped handcuffs on me. They threw me up against a car, against the wall, and onto the ground. And they charged me with a misdemeanor, interfering with a peace officer. If only there was a peace officer in the vicinity. So as I'm laying on the ground, sideways, looking out on this vista, I'm looking for Sharif and Nicole. I don't see Nicole, but I do see Sharif across the parking lot, hands behind his back. So I demanded to be taken to him. Finally, the officer did. Sharif and I are standing. We're both standing with our hands behind our back because we're handcuffed. And Sharif's arm was bleeding. And we had our credentials on, and we were demanding to be released, whereupon the Secret Service came and ripped the credentials from around our neck. The reason I knew it was Secret Service, you can't figure out who all the authorities are in these situations, and many of them do not have ID on, and or wear black or camouflage, you know, every level of authority here. But the reason I know this, and this would be critical later, is because I turned to the police officer, who when I asked him to loosen my handcuffs, because I couldn't feel my hands anymore, tighten them, I said to him, this is outrageous that you would pull the credentials from around our necks. And he said, it wasn't us, it was the Secret Service. So it was very good when, but I'll explain later to get that information. So I'm taken into the police van, as because I'm going to be processed in the police garage. And there is Nicole. Her face is bleeding. She got her credentials on. I said, she's handcuffed. I said, Nicole, what happened? And she quickly described they'd been at SPNN. They saw the riot police and the protesters outside. They saw there was going to maybe be some kind of confrontation. They raced down with camera and microphone. I mean, they wouldn't have been doing their job if they'd stayed in the studio. She started filming. Sharif was holding the microphone. She did not plan to film her own violent arrest, but then the riot police moved in on her. She was alone. This wasn't part of a chaotic situation. She's against cars, and you see this for yourself. They come at her. They start to say, move, move, but she's in a parking lot against cars. She's saying, where? And press, press. She did not know what hit her. As she's filming, they came at her from behind and in front of her, and they slammed her to the ground, face in the ground. Her camera tumbles down. They immediately pull the battery out of her camera, if you were wondering what they wanted to stop happening. Knee or boot in their back, in her back, and they start dragging her legs, so they're dragging her face through the stones of the of this rocky parking lot. And Sharif is telling the riot police to calm down. He's a very cool guy. And they take him, they throw him up against the wall, kick him twice in the chest, and take him down, bloodying his arm. They face felony riot charges. They were taken to jail. I was taken to the police garage where they erected the big cages to put the protesters in. And we didn't know what was happening outside, but I think the authorities got thousands of emails, calls, faxes, tweets, if tweets were around then in 2000, but they got a lot of flack. And after a number of hours, they let me out, and then eventually they let Sharif and Nicole out, which is very good because the show must go on and we have to do it the next morning. Anyway, I was brought back to the convention that night. You know, now it was over. And I was in the NBC skybox. I was being interviewed. And when the camera was turned off, an NBC reporter came over and said, I don't get it. Why wasn't I arrested? So I said, oh, were you out covering the protest too? He said, no. I said, oh, so that's the thing. I don't get arrested in the skybox either. You know, we have a job that is being at the convention center, also interviewing delegates and getting into the corporate suites to find out who's sponsoring the Republican Governors Association and the Democratic Senatorial Campaign Committee, you know, trying to get into these little suites and reaching for those chocolate-covered strawberries and at the same time finding out who's paying for this. But also going out onto the streets to where the uninvited guests are, and there are often thousands of them. You know, democracy is a messy thing, and it's our job to capture it all, and we shouldn't have to get a record when we put things on the record. So we sued the St. Paul and Minneapolis police and the Secret Service, and this was a problem for the Secret Service because they wanted to be severed. They said this wasn't true. But, you know, we had the police then testifying against the Secret Service because they were the ones, the guy who tightened the handcuffs on me, was the one who told me that it wasn't us, it was the Secret Service, it wasn't the police. And ultimately, we won a six-figure settlement. After a few years, we were brought back in to St. Paul. Yeah. And part of it was to, the deal was that they would train the St. Paul police and how to deal with the press. And we felt this was critical. We were leading up to the next convention in 2012. And, you know, this was a moment where we felt we had to stop. It is not easy to engage in these lawsuits. It's the last thing you want to do. But it's essential to protect, to ensure, to push for the functioning of a democratic society. So we wanted to let the word be known. Where would we hold our news conference? We flew back to New York and we thought, where would the greatest volume, the greatest number of police be? And also protesters, because police shouldn't be illegally arresting protesters either. So we went to Zuccotti Park. This was in the middle of Occupy Wall Street, and we held our news conference there to an audience of hundreds of police officers as well as protesters, talking about how important the free flow of information is, and that reporters play a special role, and that we must be allowed to do our job. So I want to talk, though, about 1 year, because in this book, Democracy Now, 20 years covering the movements changing America, David, Denis, and I are pulling from, culling the great resources of the last 20 years of Democracy Now. It is amazing how this incredible group of journalists and videographers have brought you the voices of people all over the world. Now, I want to say we've been very thrilled that the book came out in mid-April and debuted on the New York Times bestseller list. That's fantastic. And, you know, it's great also because the New York Times doesn't like to mention Democracy Now, and they rarely do. Now, our other five books also hit the list, but we thought we'd be very explicit this time. Democracy Now. This is the page they don't have control over, right? It's just a mathematical formula. It would have to be printed. And why does it matter? Why does it matter to get on that list? So I hope everyone gets a book or gets two books. Maybe you want to give one to a library. It matters because, unlike Common Good Bookstore, many of the bookstores in this country just stock the bestseller list. I mean, prison books, prison libraries even, are tending in that direction. And many good people go into these places and they want to expand their minds, they want to challenge their imaginations. And we want to open new universes and galaxies to them, provide a roadmap in all of these places to independent voices, independent media. Where is it? And it takes getting up there. And it isn't easy, but step by step, we can really do it together. So 1 year that we chronicle, 1 year that's an example of the power of movements, of covering the movements. And by the way, because Denis isn't here, we don't have the daily digest for you to sign up to get our daily headlines. So if you want to either hand me your email address out, oh no, I'm going to be here signing. Or you can text the word Democracy Now, one word, to the number 66866, 66866. You'll get back a request for your email. You put it in, and that's how you've signed up. Then you'll get a request for approval in your email. So 66866, you text the word Democracy Now, one word, and you can sign up that way for our daily digest. And it'll send you our news headlines and alerts. Also, if you take pictures or you make any comments tonight, if you could put it out there, tweet it. If you could use the hashtag covering the movements, that's how we're keeping track. So again, you just text the word Democracy Now and where it's a 66866, and you get a request for your email and you pop it in. So 1 year, the power of movements, 2011. But I want to start in the end of 2010, December, the Tunisian Revolution, sparked by a young man named Mohamed Bouazizi, who came out of university, no opportunity, despotic dictator, corrupt. Mohamed goes into the, has no opportunity, so goes to sell fruit and vegetables in the marketplace. The authorities take his scale, and he can't take it anymore, and he sets himself on fire. That's that that sparked the Tunisian Revolution. Also WikiLeaks. That was another thing, another factor. You know, WikiLeaks founded by Julian Assange, WikiLeaks that released the Iraq war logs, the Afghan war logs, the State Department cables, millions of them, believing that transparency serves a democratic society. We have a chapter on, you know, Ed Snowden and Julian Assange and Chelsea Manning. Julian Assange holed up in the Ecuadorian embassy where he has political asylum, would like to get to Ecuador, but is afraid if he steps foot outside, ultimately he will be extradited to the United States, where he fears, well, we think there's a signed, this sealed indictment against him. He's afraid he could end up for the rest of his life in jail. And if you think he is paranoid, does the name Chelsea Manning ring a bell? Yeah. Who's serving 37 years at Leavenworth. So why would WikiLeaks have anything to do with this? It's not like the Tunisians didn't know they had a corrupt dictator. But they realized in the State Department cables that the U.S. knew it too, but the U.S. continued to shore him up to the tune of millions of dollars and just increased their anger. They rose up, they threw out their dictator, and then that sparked the Egyptian Revolution, which was astounding. A million people, every sector of society, ultimately after 18 days, threw out their long-time dictator, Mubarak. What's happened with the Egyptian Revolution now is frightening. It's taken a very dangerous turn. So many of the young activists that were involved with the original revolution have been jailed. And so we will, of course, continue to follow that. But I think the Arab Spring then helped to spark Wisconsin.
Yeah.
Right? Woo! I mean, we're going to be in Wisconsin next week. I mean, what happened? 150,000 people rise up. I mean, I think Governor Walker contributed to the uprising. Governor Walker, right, who says he's going to bust the public unions, the teachers and the nurses, not the police and the firefighters, right? He assured them, not you guys. Governor Walker's problem was that the police and the firefighters were married to the teachers and the nurses. So they all rose up together. I mean, again, I'm from New York. I never saw scenes like this in the state capitol where they occupied it. They slept there. They had teach-ins there. I saw young people with dreads, you know, down their back drumming on anything they could in front of the governor's office with police rocking out next to them. I hadn't seen that before. I didn't notice if any of those police were the ones who had arrested me, but we'll let that go for a moment. And I saw some of the biggest guys I'd ever seen in my life, the Oshkosh prison guards. And I went up to them and I said, "Who did you vote for?" And they said, "Governor Walker." I said, "So what are you doing here?" And they said, "Protesting Governor Walker." Outside, in the freezing cold, over 100,000 protesters, older gentlemen, white hair, glasses, holding a homemade placard that said, "IRS auditors against Walker." This is what was happening. And I, you know, Wisconsin's an interesting place. I mean, it's the home of the John Birch Society, the racist, segregationist, anti-civil rights, anti-king organization that was co-founded by Fred Koch, the father of the oil barons, Charles and David Koch. But also AFSCME. It's the home of AFSCME, 1932, the American Federation of State, County, Municipal Employees. And I looked out on the sea of protest, and I saw across the grounds the Wisconsin State Labor History Museum. And labor history. If you think that, well, this didn't amount to a hill of beans, the governor was reelected, well, he did run for president and had to pull out pretty fast, and I think this had something to do with it. And you never know what turn these protests will take. Go back to 1968, Memphis, Tennessee, April 4th, 1968, the day Dr. King was assassinated. What was he doing in Memphis? He'd simply gone there to stand with sanitation workers who were trying to organize a local of AFSCME. Go back a year to the day before that, April 4th, 1967, in Riverside Church in New York, Dr. King giving a speech against the Vietnam War. His inner circle said, "Don't do this, Martin. You've got the most powerful person on earth wrapped around your finger, right? The president of the United States, Lyndon Johnson. You got him to sign the Voting Rights Act, the Civil Rights Act. This isn't your war." And Dr. King said, "No. I see the war abroad, Vietnam, connected to the war at home." Yeah. He wanted to take on the triple threat he saw of materialism, militarism, and racism. And he gave that famous speech where he said, "My country, the United States, is the greatest purveyor of violence on earth." He was excoriated by the corporate press. I mean, I have the Life magazine issue, Time magazine, Washington Post. They said his speech sounded like a script from Radio Hanoi. He'd done a disservice to his cause, his country, his people. And he just doubled down, spoke louder, spoke more often against the war, and would ultimately be killed. But I want to move forward to the summer of 2011. Keystone XL protests outside the White House, the ring around the Rose Garden, thousands of people protesting, 1,200 arrested, among them Naomi Klein. It was her first arrest, and she, along with Bill McKibben, 350.org, joined many others. And read every one of Naomi's books. Read The Shock Doctrine. Read This Changes Everything, Capitalism Versus the Climate. Read No Logo, Taking Aim at Brand Bullies. They took on the government. It wasn't a Democrat thing. It wasn't a Republican thing. They were protesting, calling on President Obama at the time to say no to the Keystone XL pipeline. Move forward 3 weeks to September 17, 2011. Thousands stream into Zuccotti Park in New York. Occupy Wall Street. And they set up an encampment. The corporate media hardly covered them, almost not at all. The media moguls are driving by, the elite press are right there, media metropolis of the world, no coverage. But then they have to, it's getting ridiculous. I remember Erin Burnett had just started her program Out Front on CNN. Her first piece on Occupy was called Seriously? And that's what they did. When they started to cover it, they just mocked it. And what did they say? They said, what do these people represent? They can't even decide. You know, they're against the death penalty, against war, against racism, against inequality, you know, concerned about climate change. And I thought, oh my God, the media's listening, right? Yes, all of those issues. Like King, they saw them as a seamless web. The media saw it as their weakness. I saw it as their strength. And they said, why can't they choose a spokesperson to speak for them? You know, they are a leaderful movement, not a leaderless movement. And I actually see what's happening this year in the 2016 election. I see this as a kind of resurgence of Occupy. You know, they tap something extremely important. If you say, what did that amount to? You know, all the campments were eviscerated by the police, and where do they all go? Well, you can't minimize what happened. They occupied the language. I think the word occupy was the most looked up in 2011, or the most used. You say the word 1% or 99%, absolutely everyone knows what you mean. You change the language, you change the world. And again, I think we're seeing that. We're seeing that this year. You know, Bernie Sanders is not creating a movement. He is tapping into a movement of frustration, of anger, of people who've been organizing for a long time finding a voice. And I want to talk about the elections for a moment because they're not finding that voice in the corporate media. The corporate media has certainly tried to keep it down. It doesn't hit the media radar screen. This is a little diversion from the year 2011, but we'll just jump forward to 2016 for a second. When I was in San Francisco a few weeks ago, we were racing to the airport so that neither of us would miss the plane, and we got a call from AJ Plus. Would you stop by our studios because we want to interview you? You know, AJ Plus is Al Jazeera Online. Al Jazeera America has sadly folded. I hope Al Jazeera doesn't follow suit, but AJ Plus is very successful, the digital version. I said, I'm so sorry, we're racing to the airport. We don't have time for anything ever. Meaning just in general, it's just racing. That's the theme of this tour. And they said, oh, please, like 3 minutes. I said, 3 minutes, where are you? They said, right on the way to the airport. I said, literally 3 minutes? Yeah, 3 minutes, okay. So I raced out, Dennis is like not even out of the car yet. I sit down, do the interview, say hello to the folks at AJ Plus, come out, and we race to the airport and we catch our plane. So, a week later, like last week, they posted the 3 minutes online. I haven't checked today or yesterday, but as of like 2 days ago, it had 11.7 million views. I mean, it is astounding. Now, I didn't say anything. Did any of you, not that I can see any of you, but did any of you see this little video? Okay, I see some hands. I always like to see how virtual translates into, you know, actual real people. I mean, I didn't say anything different than probably most of you think. but it just doesn't appear in the media. I was invited on CNN a few times in the last months by Brian Stelter, who is a former New York Times reporter who now does Reliable Sources, the media criticism show on Sunday mornings, and he asked me to critique the media. And I didn't single out his network as I was speaking on his network because I said I can't. I can't single out CNN because I can't tell the difference between CNN, MSNBC, and Fox, because Donald Trump sounds the same on all three networks. When you have that little, you know, lower third where it says breaking news, and it's whatever he's thinking about at the moment, live, interrupting anything else. And, you know, don't take it from me. The Tyndall Report 2015 said Donald Trump got 23 times the coverage of Bernie Sanders. I think ABC World News Tonight gave Donald Trump 81 minutes, Bernie Sanders 20 seconds for 2015. I'd like to know what Bernie Sanders did that was so newsworthy that would get those 20 seconds. But anyway, and let's look at one primary night, March 15th. I think they called it this year Super Tuesday 3. It was Missouri, Illinois, North Carolina, Florida, and Ohio. Okay, and the media wall-to-wall coverage of that primary night, as it should be, all of them. So they play Senator Marco Rubio. Remember Marco Rubio? Senator from Florida. He loses his home state and he pulls out. They play Governor John Kasich. Remember Governor Kasich? He won his home state, the first primary he won, Ohio, and they played his victory speech, and as they should. They played Ted Cruz. They played Hillary Clinton. She had just won Florida, Ohio, and North Carolina. But Illinois, her home state, and Missouri were too close to call, neck and neck with Bernie Sanders. And the media said that, neck and neck, too close to call. It's going late into the night. She was smart to give her speech then while she's still ahead. She's won these three states. She does, they play it. And then they're waiting for Donald Trump, and they're waiting, and they're waiting, and they're waiting, and they're showing a little square in the upper right-hand corner, remember, of an empty podium in one of his Florida mansions, and they're waiting, and then he's going to give a press conference, I think they said. He's pioneered this thing, giving a press conference at the end of a primary night. He did it a few weeks before, and they played this hour of Donald Trump trumpeting Trump water, Trump steaks, Trump magazines. It was like this bizarre. And they never interrupted him. In fact, Hillary Clinton spoke in the middle of it, and this is in another primary night. They recorded her and played it after, but they didn't dare interrupt Donald Trump. So anyway, this night they're waiting and the waiting, and you know, the pundits, the who know so little about so much, are just on all of the networks, are just filling the airtime, waiting, and he finally speaks, and he doesn't have a news conference, he just speaks for a half hour, and that's fine. And that pretty much did it, right? It wraps up the night. You got Clinton, Cruz, Kasich, Rubio, Trump. There's no one else, is there? Bernie who? Now, we did a leg of this journey through Arizona, Flagstaff, Tucson, and Phoenix, so I know this for a fact, Phoenix. Where was Bernie Sanders that night? Why didn't the media even speculate? I mean, just like, has he gone to sleep? Has he taken the night off? It was neck and neck, like Missouri and Illinois. Where was Senator Sanders' speech? None of the networks talked about it. In fact, he was giving a speech in Phoenix to thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of people. I don't care if you're for him or against him, but the fact is he was speaking and he was the only one left out. I think he started before Trump, and by that, you know, he gets one to every 23 minutes of Trump in 2015. They could have played 1 minute of Bernie Sanders and then immediately gone to the half hour of Trump. But no, they don't even, it's the vanishing. So we decided that night, we weren't planning to do this, to play an excerpt of Bernie Sanders' speech the next morning. Who would have thunk it? Who would have thought it's a revolutionary act to play the speech of a major party candidate on a primary night, hotly contested, or the next morning? But that's what it's become, and it's really unacceptable. And the other thing I've challenged the networks on that I talked about on AJ Plus and on CNN, I said, how about an electoral season without polls? Look at the millions of dollars they pour into these polls. And you know, you turn on any of the networks and she's ahead 20-20-20, she's moving up on the right, he's coming down on the left, she's moving up the middle. I mean, it sounds like a horse race. And you are mesmerized, but at the end of the day, what have you learned? Nothing. Why are they doing this? And then Every primary and caucus, like the last one in Indiana, right, they get it wrong. They discuss until the next primary caucus how they got it so wrong. What about not having these? What do we gain by these polls, right? I mean, most of the time they're wrong, but what do we gain by these polls? I don't care what my librarian or family or neighbor or professor or anyone thinks when it comes to who I'm going to vote for. I want to know the record of these candidates, how it compares to the promises. And that's what the media should be doing, using the same energy, resources, investigating these politicians and business people. And you still might say, wait a second, I sort of like to know what the breakdowns are. I actually do too. But there is a fact-based poll. Every caucus and primary is a poll. At the end of the night, you find out who voted, who didn't. The big story is who doesn't. Like 80% of the people don't vote in primaries and caucuses. So if you ever get discouraged, you say, how does this reflect what Americans... Well, you know, we're talking about a tiny percentage, and then a particular candidate from a particular party, it's an even tinier percentage. But who votes, who doesn't, the racial breakdown, the economic breakdown, the gender breakdown, all of this is fascinating. And you get that every single week because these primaries and caucuses are every single week. And that is interesting. And where do they get the money for all of this, these networks? And that's the most interesting. I mean, they get millions of dollars from, well, let's do it the other way. These candidates are raising an obscene amount of money. And why are they doing it? The vast majority of it goes into the networks to pay for advertising. Yes, the networks are the ones who are profiting from this corrupt drenching of politics in money. They're the ones who are getting the money, which is why we need independent media. So, let me go back to Occupy 2011. So that happened, and the signs that were carried by many people, and I'm coming to the end of this year now in this talk, and I'm really looking forward to talking to you guys individually. If you don't want to wait around, remember stories@democracynow.org. Send story ideas, people, contact information, articles you want us to read. The whole team at Democracy Now! Reads it. So you go from September 17, 2011, and the whole Occupy movement. Among the signs people carried when they moved into Zuccotti Park, some of them was, I am Troy Davis, too much doubt. And that's where I want to turn right now. Yes, I am Troy Davis, too much doubt. On September 21st, 4 days after Zuccotti Park, after the Occupy encampment began, Troy Davis was slated to die. Yes, we were reporting live. We went directly from Occupy Wall Street to Jackson, Georgia, where Georgia's death row prison resides, awaiting news about whether the U.S. Supreme Court would spare Troy Davis's life. I am Troy Davis became this rallying cry of a growing international movement to stop his execution. The effort had grown. It included not only traditional anti-death penalty activists, it included prosecutors, prison wardens, a former U.S. president, and the Pope. This is the story of a struggle against death that refuses to die. Now, who was Troy Davis? Well, he grew up in Savannah with his three sisters and his brother. On the night of August 18, 1989, 18-year-old Troy, African-American, went to Charlie Brown's pool hall with a friend. In the parking lot outside, Red Coles, a neighborhood tough, was arguing loudly with a homeless man named Larry Young. Several witnesses testified later that Coles pistol-whipped Young. Pool hall patrons came outside to see what was going on. Troy tried to intervene in the fight, but fled when Coles threatened him with a gun. At 1:15 in the morning, Mark McPhail, a white off-duty Savannah police officer who was working as a security guard at a Greyhound bus station next door, came outside to break up the fight. Gunshots pierced the summer night. Moments later, McPhail lay dying with a bullet wound to the head and another to the heart. He never drew his gun. Mark McPhail was a hero cop. He tried to save this homeless man, and he was killed. The question was, Officer McPhail was killed. The question was, who killed him? Red Coles races to the police station with his lawyer and points the finger at Troy Davis. Now, Troy doesn't know this. He's now off in Atlanta the next day looking for a job with a friend. His face is plastered over all the newscasts, you know, wanted, this 18-year-old boy. And his sister, Martina, is desperate. They try to reach Troy. They reach him. They say, Troy, you have to come home. You have to, you know, turn yourself in. You've got to explain what's going on. Now, Martina is a heroine. I've interviewed her many times. Denis landed. Martina is a heroine. She was a Persian Gulf Army nurse. She came back to this country because she had breast cancer. She was diagnosed with breast cancer. So she starts to try to save her own life. And in so doing, she also decides she's going to save all women's lives. And her face adorns the mammogram vans of all of the Savannah mammogram, the mammogram vans of Savannah. She wants to encourage black women and poor women, make sure you get a mammogram. She's this leading light, and she's honored as such, along with Nancy Pelosi in Washington. But now she's not only trying to save her own life and these women's lives, but her own brother's life. She races to Atlanta, says, get in the car, Troy. They come home. Troy turns himself to the Chatham County Sheriff's Office. The teenager thinks it's a case of mistaken identity. He'll just simply clear up the confusion. Instead, he's charged with murder. He's held for 2 years. He's tried. The jury deliberates for 2 hours, returns a guilty verdict. On August 30th, 1991, Troy Davis, age 20, was sentenced to die. Davis would spend the next 20 years on death row. During that time, 7 of the 9 non-police witnesses recanted or changed their testimony, many of them saying they were coerced by police to point the finger at Troy. One who did not recant of the 9 was Red Coles, who most pointed the finger at to say he was the actual killer. No physical evidence linked Davis to the shooting. So there's your background. Now I want to talk about September 21st, the day that Troy Davis had his 4th death warrant deadline. He had 3 others. They were all vacated. And so when we came down to Jackson, we did not know what was going to happen. But we knew we needed to be there. If we could have broadcast from the death chamber, we would have. We believe in showing the images. So we were on the grounds of the prison. The satellite trucks were all on the periphery of the prison grounds. That's where the prison guards put them. But, I mean, we wanted to be near the protesters. There was a pen for 150 protesters. Martina was in the middle now in a wheelchair. She would die weeks later of breast cancer. She was surrounded by human rights leaders like the head of NAACP, the head of Amnesty International, and others. People had come from around the world. The students from Morehouse, King's alma mater, and Spelman, all carrying candles from Atlanta, 1,000 people across the street. There were protests in Iceland and Germany and England and Japan and France. We knew if we were going to cover it, we had to do it like the big boys. We got ourselves a satellite truck that we rented from Atlanta. You know, it comes with the videographers, with the satellite truck operators. We were going to do this and not stop broadcasting until we knew what would happen that night. And I was annoyed because our satellite truck was late. They finally came up on the grounds. We didn't know these guys. We had just rented them. You know, CNN uses them, Fox uses them. They come up on the grounds of the prison in the truck. They roll down the window and say, where do you want the satellite man? And so I said, well, the prison guards are saying you have to put them over there with the other satellite trucks. No, where do you want the satellite truck? I said, well, I was like thinking about over there by the protest pen. And they just barreled this truck over to the pen. I was beginning to warm up to them. And then, you know, the prison guards come running over because they were very clear. And these guys get out of the truck and they take out their cameras. They were bigger than the Oshkosh prison guards. And the prison guards backed off. And they handed me the mic and they form a like protective semicircle around me and said, where are you gonna stand? So I said, I was right up against the rope so I can reach the microphone over and talk to people. And they said, okay, start the show. We began the broadcast at 6. We had gotten the press packet from the Department of Corrections. On the first pages, it talked about Troy's schedule that day. It said that he would see family until 3, but then they would have to clear out so he could get the routine physical. Routine physical? The state is going to execute him in 4 hours? I mean, do they care if he has cholesterol? And you know what had happened in Texas a while before that? A man on death row had attempted suicide. They raced him to the hospital, got him better, and then they executed him. Then the next page talked about what Troy would have for dinner. He had refused the, you know, Last Supper, where you can have ice cream sundaes and steak, anything you want. And so they said, this would be the standard fare that Troy Davis was offered. In detail, quote, grilled cheeseburgers, oven brown potatoes, baked beans, coleslaw, cookies, and a grape beverage. Another page listed the lethal cocktail that would follow. It was just 4 lines. It said, pentobarbital, pancuronium bromide, potassium chloride, and Ativan, in parentheses, a sedative. The pentobarbital anesthetizes, the pancuronium bromide paralyzes, and the potassium chloride stops the heart. Troy Davis refused the sedative and the Last Supper. By 7 p.m., the U.S. Supreme Court was reportedly reviewing Davis's plea for a stay. The case was referred to Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas, who hailed from Pinpoint, Georgia, a community founded by freed slaves that's near Savannah, where Davis had lived. Not surprisingly, the Supreme Court denied the plea. Davis's execution began at 10:53 p.m., a prison spokesperson delivered the news to the reporters outside. Time of death, 11:08 p.m. The eyewitnesses to the execution stepped out. According to an Associated Press reporter who was there, these were Troy Davis's final words. He said, I'd like to address the McPhail family, let you know I'm not the one who killed your son, your father, your brother. I'm innocent. The incident that happened that night was not my fault. I did not have a gun. All I can ask is that you look deeper into this case so that you can really finally see the truth. I ask my family and friends to continue to fight this fight. And then he turned to his executioners and said, for those about to take my life, God have mercy on your souls, and may God bless your souls. The state of Georgia took Davis's body to Atlanta for an autopsy, charging the family for the transportation. On Troy Davis's death certificate, the cause of death is listed simply as homicide. As we stood on the grounds of the prison just after Troy Davis was executed, the Georgia Department of Corrections threatened to pull the plug on our broadcast. The show was over. I was reminded of what Mahatma Gandhi reportedly answered when asked what he thought of Western civilization. He said, I think it would be a good idea. Now, I want to end with the end of the year in Durban, South Africa, the UN Climate Summit that year. You know, Democracy Now! Goes to all the UN Climate Summits. We went to Copenhagen, we went to Cancun, we're in Cochabamba for the People's Summit in Bolivia. We went to Durban in 2011, to Doha in 2012, then to Poland, to Peru, and last year we went to Paris. And we cover every single day our complete broadcast covering this absolutely critical movement. Yes, I do deeply feel that people care about this issue when they know. They care about war and peace, care about inequality, they care about climate change, the fate of the planet. It's not a fringe minority, it's not a silent majority, it's the silenced majority silenced by the corporate media. It is critical we understand what is at stake. The rest of the world comes to these summits. You might say, why waste the fuel? What actually happens in them? It's outside. The thousands of people who are not invited in, who are not accredited, the 15-year-old Maldives boy who comes to the climate summit to say, my country will be submerged. The people of sub-Saharan Africa who talk about the desertification of Africa, the cooking of their continent. These are the voices that need to be heard. They are so much more sophisticated when it comes to understanding climate change and the rest of the world. They have debates, yes, but they're debates about what they can do about it. We in this country have debates, but the debates are around whether human beings have anything to do with climate change. the science is settled. It's as if every time we talked about the planet Earth, we brought on someone from the Flat Earth Society for balance. And I also hold the meteorologists on television and radio partly responsible. They shouldn't get whatever the license is they get when they become a meteorologist. If they don't say, in addition to flashing those words, climate change, and in addition to flashing the words extreme weather and severe weather, they must flash the words climate change, global warming, climate disruption. It's not just about tuning in to figure out what to wear each day. We have to figure out what to do about this. And so in Durban, something interesting happened at one of these climate summits. People from the outside were invited in, albeit at the end of the summit, but they were the youth to speak. And the youth chose as their spokesperson a young woman named Anjali Apadurai. She was a student at College of the Atlantic in Bar Harbor, Maine, where we're going to be speaking this Sunday. And she got up and spoke with the youth surrounding the room. And Anjali Apadurai said, "I speak for more than half the world's population. We are the silent majority. You've given us a seat in this hall, but our interests are not on the table. What does it take to get a stake in this game? Lobbyists, corporate influence, money? You've been negotiating all of my life. You've failed to meet pledges, you've missed targets, you've broken promises, but you've heard this all before. We're in Africa, home to communities on the front line of climate change. The science tells us we have 5 years maximum. You're saying, give us 10. The starkest betrayal of your generation's responsibility to ours is that you call this ambition. Where is the courage in these rooms? Now is not the time for incremental action. In the long run, these will be seen as the defining moments of an era in which narrow self-interest prevailed over science, reason, and common compassion." She said, "There is real ambition in this room, but it's been dismissed as radical, deemed not politically possible. Stand with Africa. Long-term thinking is not radical. What's radical is to completely alter the planet's climate, to betray the future of my generation, and to condemn millions to death by climate change. What's radical is to write off the fact that change is within our reach. 2011 was the year in which the silent majority found their voice, the year when the bottom shook the top. 2011 was the year when the radical became reality." And then she quoted Nelson Mandela, who said, "It always seems impossible until it's done." And she looked out at the crowd of faces, the bureaucrats, the delegates, the scientists, the world leaders, and said, "So distinguished delegates and governments around the world, governments of the developed world, deep cuts now, get it done." And I want to end where I began, back in World War II. I talked about the beginning of Pacifica, but I want to go back there to Nazi Germany, to a brother and sister named Hans and Sophie Scholl, who together with their professor and other students and workers formed the White Rose Collective. They thought, what can we do in the face of the Nazi atrocity? They weren't Jewish, they were German Christians. And they decided if they could just get information to the Germans so that the Germans would never be able to say we didn't know. They published a series of pamphlets. And on one of the pamphlets were written the words, "We will not be silent." They had these dropped everywhere under cover of night. Oh, in alleyways, in schoolyards, in marketplaces. And then Hans and Sophie and their professor were captured. They were charged, they were tried, they were convicted, and they were beheaded. But that philosophy, that motto, should be the Hippocratic Oath of the media today, should be the Hippocratic Oath of us all today. We will not be silent. Democracy Now!